This will change the way that you look at the security of your phone. And while this attack isn't anything new, it's getting more exposure now thanks to a popular video that surprisingly doesn't come from a tech YouTuber.
What did you need to steal from me in order to become me?
At the very simplest, all we would need is your phone number.
My name's Josh, and if you haven't seen this video from Veritasium yet, I recommend you go check it out. I love his channel, and this particular video is crazy good. For those who don't want to sit through 30 minutes of it though, I want to provide a high-level summary along with some critical takeaways that will alter the way that you approach security for your mobile phone. If you've been following all things secured for a while now, you're probably already aware of what's known as a SIM swap, an attack that usually requires a bit of social engineering to convince a mobile provider to swap a SIM card from your phone to the attacker's phone. It's been a problem for years, and although some mobile providers have made steps to create a solution, the truth is that it's still an issue. Now, there are other attacks that require either physical access to the phone or some kind of manipulation of you, the target. But what if an attack didn't require any human interaction at all? That's what this particular video from Veritasium showed. In collaboration with experienced hackers, they demonstrated how easy it is to exploit vulnerabilities in what's known as the SS7 standard for mobile communication. Now, this standard was first developed in the 1980s, and as you might guess, it's still being used today despite having some serious security flaws. You can think of SS7 as a kind of language that different phone companies use to talk to each other, both domestically and especially internationally. The SS7 exploit means that an attacker can sneak into this network and pretend to be a phone company, which would allow them to reroute phone calls, text messages, or even track your location. While this isn't an attack that just anybody can perform, it's also not one of those state-sponsored only kind of attacks. You would need to be targeted, and it would cost thousands of dollars, but it's not impossible. Honestly, I'm not that concerned about being the victim of such an attack, and I doubt that you are either, but that's not the point. The concerning thing here is that no matter how careful you are, no matter how many protections you put in place, you're only as secure as the platform that you're using. And when it comes to these mobile providers, they're all still using this SS7 protocol with no clear timeline for an upgrade to a better system. So what does this mean for you and I? This highlights a few things that I think are important for us to understand. First, you need to recognize that anything you do through your mobile network is inherently vulnerable. You should treat SMS texts and phone calls as if somebody could intercept them or listen in on them. Again, this probably isn't happening, but it could. And this is why it's better to start moving over to encrypted services like Signal for text messaging or other encrypted services for your voice calls. This is yet another reason why receiving 2FA authentication codes via SMS text is never a good idea. I know that some services give us no other option, but as I shared in this video explanation of my account security strategy, I always opt for the higher form of two-factor authentication offered, which is hopefully either an authenticator app or some sort of physical security key like YubiKey. Now, while these aren't foolproof, these types of 2FA are not subject to the same kind of mobile network vulnerabilities that SMS text is. Finally, and this is what's most interesting to me, all of us need to understand that as long as a SIM card is being used in our phone, we are being tracked in some way. And yes, this applies even to eSIMs. Again, I'm not trying to be an alarmist, don't go throw your phone away, but there are a lot of misconceptions about using VPNs, advanced protection programs, and other security measures. At the end of the day, your SIM card leaves a footprint that these software measures cannot remove. As long as you understand that, I think it's fine to use a SIM card. Heck, I still have an eSIM in my phone. But as we continue to dump more and more of our daily lives and personal information onto these devices, it's worth stopping to consider the implications. For some people, it might be worthwhile to consider a second secure device without a SIM card, particularly if you're a high-profile executive, an influencer, or a public figure. I'm currently testing out the above phone that you see here, in which I haven't put any SIM card or eSIM. This isn't sponsored, and honestly, I haven't used it long enough to give my opinion, but it's good to know that these kind of options exist. For others of you, you might just want to limit how much you store on your SIM-loaded device. if accessing a mobile network is necessary, and I completely understand if it is, there are services like Ifani that can at least protect you against the threat of a SIM swap. And you can learn more about how that service works in this video. And of course, for many of you, there's no need to make any significant change. It's good to just know the risks and make informed decisions based on that knowledge. Your phone isn't as private as you think it is, and solutions like a VPN don't protect you from as much as you think it does. Be smart, know the risks, and act accordingly.